If we were to look at the tabernacle of David, the tabernacle that David put in place, he actually had hired musicians that would worship before the tabernacle 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's what he thought of worship. He knew that God inhabits the praises of his people. So when we praise him, we can expect him to be in our midst. We can expect him to be with us. We can expect him to release to us some of the things that he carries. And so worship and praise is absolutely crucial. I'm convinced of that. And if we ever question that, we need to go back and read about the temptation that Jesus had in the desert when the devil tempted him with all the kingdoms of this world. And the devil offered Jesus all the kingdoms of this world if he would bow down and worship him. That's how important worship is. Obviously, the devil figured that worship was more important than all the kingdoms of the world. And so when we come before God to worship him, we have to consider how important it is. And I'm convinced that worship and prayer, they so go together. It's one of the things that the enemy will do everything he can to stop God's people from praying and stop God's people from worshiping. Those are two key elements that actually have so much power in the spiritual realm that we underestimate. But the devil knows how much power there is in worship and how much power there is in prayer. So he does everything he can to be able to get us off track and get us into a ditch in some other areas. Now, Father, this morning I thank you for your holy written and anointed word. I thank you for the power that's in your word. I thank you that Jesus said that my words are spirit. The words that I speak to you are spirits and they are life. So God, I thank you for the life of God that's being imparted today, Lord, as your word is being spoken. We thank you for the grace of God that's on the word of God that can change our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Romans 12:2, and do not be conformed to this world. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. There is a purpose for that, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect, and the perfect will of God. God wants us to be transformed. He wants us not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed. We cannot be transformed according to God's direction in any other way but by taking the Word of God and allowing it to wash over us. The Word of God comes to us as a seed. Everybody say seed. The Word of God comes to us as a seed, and it's up to us what we do with that seed. In other words, we can let that seed lie dormant, or we can cultivate all the ground around it and cause it to be watered well and begin, it'll germinate and begin to produce an abundant fruit. It's up to us. Every revelation that you and I get comes as a seed. And if it will grow, if it will blossom, if it produces fruit, then you know it's a seed that God, of seed of God's word. If you get a revelation and it just after a while is kind of flat and is not growing anymore and it's not really producing anything, you can bet that it's something that is not of God. It's something that God hasn't planted. Because the things that God involves in always produces, always. And so when we take the Word of God and realize that we are not be conformed to this world, but we are to be transformed by the renewing of our mind, then we can expect our mind to shift, to change, to begin thinking in another way. Do you realize that you need to change your thinking? Some of you say, well, I'm a Christian, so I really, you know, I got my thinking straight. No, no, no. If you take that attitude, you'll never get any farther. You'll never get any further along in the things of the kingdom of God. Our minds have to shift, have to change, have to be transformed to continually be able to be influential in the arenas that God has placed us in. You see, you and I have been put here for a reason, for a purpose, and it is to influence our sphere of authority around us. We'll get into that just a little bit later. But we are to be conformed. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:20, now then we are ambassadors for Christ as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. And so we are to be influencers in the sphere of authority that God has given us to live in. We are to influence people as an ambassador would influence a foreign nation. We are to be influencers. I'm just reading some word here and talking a little bit because I know God wants me to go someplace and I'm trying to find it. I'm trying to get there, but I don't want to be in a hurry. But I want us to have our ears astute to what the Spirit is saying this morning, because He's going to speak directly to individuals today, a word that can change your life if you'll treat the word as a seed of God and you'll honor it. We are born again. If we are born again, we are already in the process of transformation. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says, "But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of God." So, if we are born again, we are already going through a process of transformation. Something is already happening in us. If we are moving forward with God, we are going to what the Apostle Paul calls going from glory to glory. When you came into the kingdom of God, when you turned your life over to God, glory came. In other words, you began to honor the things that God honored, and He began to place His glory on you. And when you started out then, and you honored that, you were able to go from glory to glory. Not from glory to a lesser state, but from glory to a greater state, so that God could have more and more influence in your life. So you are already in a process of transformation, and you must realize that you need to go a little bit further than you are already. You're here on earth for a while. We're all here on earth for a while, and there's some things that we can do here on earth that we're not going to be able to do in heaven. And so we can't waste our time while we're here on earth, because there's some things that we can only do here. And I believe part of that is transformation. I believe that there's things that we can transform here on earth that we won't necessarily be able to when we get over there. So we can't waste our time here. We have to get at it. Kind of reminds me of the man who came to his son. He said, "Son," he said, "you're almost 30 now. It's about time you started looking at a career." And he said, "Well, Dad, I'm only 22 years old. It'll be 8 years more before I'm 30. He said, "Yeah, that's true. But how long is it going to be until you're 22 again? We're on earth here for a while. And we might say we got lots of time left here on earth. But we're not going to be here forever. And whatever we're going to do, we better get at it. We better move into the things that God has called us to, because we all want to hear some special words when we get to heaven. I'm sure you're like me. When I get to heaven, one of the things that I want to hear, I don't know if they'd be actually these words or not, but I want to hear something like, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Remember, Jesus talked about the master who gave the servant some talents and gave him some money, and he told him to invest it. When he come back, they'd have to give an account. And the ones who really handled, who were good stewards with the finances, they were told to enter into the joy of the Lord. "Well done, good and faithful servant." Now notice this, that the reason why the man was given those words, "Well done and good and faithful servant," was that he was a good servant of something that didn't belong to him. He was a good steward of something that wasn't his, it was somebody else's. Now, I want us to realize that while we're here on earth this morning, there's something called time that belongs to God. Actually, He created it. And He wants us to be good stewards with the time that we have been placed here on earth. And there's something you and I are going to have to be given account for. When something comes into our hands that we know is a gift, then we have to be a good steward with that gift. If we ever want to hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of the Lord." We're going to have to be given account one day. And I think sometimes, you know, we as Christians, we call upon the grace of God, and we're so glad that the grace of God, has made a way for us to be able to stand before Him. And sometimes I think we take grace as if nothing else matters because of the grace of God. It doesn't matter what we do, that we'll never really have to give an account But the Bible clearly states that we will have to give an account for the time that we've been here. So we're going to have to stand before God one day and give an account for the way we use the things that he gave us here on earth. And grace is one of the things that he's given us. Grace is one of the things that he's lavished upon us that we can use not only for our own welfare, but for the sake of others. In other words, when some people are in a place of destruction, when some people are in a place of an unhealthy situation, you and I are called to extend grace to them. When somebody misses it, it might be another brother and sister, and they mess up and they say something they shouldn't say, you and I are called to extend grace to them. To, in some cases, be like Catherine Kuhlman, who, when someone would say something mean to her, and there's lots of people said lots of things mean to her, a great healing evangelist, she would say to her secretary, let's just pretend that they never said that. Let's just act like they never said that. Well, that's extending grace to another individual. You need to embrace them. You know, somebody comes in from off the street and they might, have been in all kinds of situations in their life. There might have been, call girls. They might have been prostitutes. They could have been anything at all. When they come into the church family extends grace to them and say, but for the sake of God, I could have gotten that mess too. And so we just want to help you. We want to receive you. And we love you enough. We care enough about you not to leave you in the state that you come in. I'm so glad that God loved me enough to not leave me in the state I was when I came into the kingdom of God. He loved me enough to begin convicting me and to shift things up so I'd be transformed, so I would change. God will meet us where we're at, but he doesn't want to leave us where we're at. He wants to lead us into freedom. He wants us to walk in holiness before him because he knows that's the greatest place of freedom. So grace is absolutely crucial, walking in grace. So today, I want to share with you a few things in the area of the gifts and callings of God, because God gives us gifts to use here while we're here on earth. Now, I want you to notice something. There's some things that God gives us here on earth that are profitable for earth, but are not necessarily going to be the profitable in heaven. But I want to talk to you this morning about some of the areas that are profitable here on earth. The gifts, the callings of God that are here for us while we're here on earth. One of the things we want to look at is, how does God give gifts? How does God decide which gift goes where? How does he make that decision? Does he look at it the same way we do? Or does he keep us in mind? Does he keep us in mind when he's passing out gifts? Or does he do like many of us do sometimes? We give somebody something that we think that they would like. Something that we like, we give it to them because we think they'd like it, or we give it to them because we like it. I want to show you a little clip where this demonstrates this pretty good. This little clip about really gift giving. Is that ready? So her boyfriend got her something that he thought she'd like to have, a locket with his name in it. How many of you women would be thrilled with that? But that's what he wanted her to carry. So, but somebody else took the time and found out what would really make her excited, what would really was something that she really wanted. And I'm convinced that when God hands out gifts, when God passes out gifts, he knows exactly what those gifts are for. In fact, the gifts that he hands out are for your assignment that you have been given while here on earth. The gifts that come your way, the gifts that God has given you, even from the time of his conception, I believe that there has been gifts imparted to you that is significant for you to reach your destiny and to fulfill your assignment here on earth. So it's important that we recognize that there are things that God has given us, and not to make light of it, because they are actually designed to help us reach our destiny. They fit. And your gift won't fit well with somebody else. Why? Because you might like yellow polka dotted tights. and I might like something else. You see, God knows how to fit things together, and He has designed your gift according to your purpose, according to your destiny. And you will only have a sense of meeting that destiny, of fulfilling your assignment, when you're able to function in your gifting that God has given you. Now, sometimes gifts are not always easy to recognize. Sometimes gifts come through an avenue that we wouldn't expect, an avenue that we wouldn't choose, but yet a gift can still come to us. There's some things that can take place in our lives that come through us through avenues that we don't necessarily want. I want you to listen to this next clip, and really, I hesitated in showing this clip, but I'll talk about it a little after a bit, and then you'll understand why I want to show you this clip. So go ahead and show. Lots of things going through our mind when we read something like that. Now, do I consider what that tumor that she got as a gift from God? No, but I want to tell you what the gifts are actually that came through that. Notice this. She said some very wonderful things that happened to her. It will bring your whole family together. Do you suppose that there's people around that would like to have something happen in their life that would bring your whole family together? There's some things, you know, in some cases where families are broken apart. Would not that be a gift to have something happen to bring all your family together? You will feel loved. Doesn't anybody want to feel loved? That's a gift. The adoration will overwhelm you. In other words, people will say you're so strong, and they'll look at you and they'll admire you. It will recalibrate what's important in your life. If we are totally messed up, if the things that we set for our priority is different, we need a recalibration. We need to be shifted. We need to be changed. And that was the gift that came through Stacy's brain tumor. You'll be challenged, inspired, motivated, and humbled. Those are all things, all gifts that can come to us and influence us while we're here, but also what we'll carry them out into eternity as well. Your life will have new meaning, peace, health, and happiness when these gifts come. The next time you face something that is unwelcome, consider that God could be using it to release a gift that will follow you into eternity. Now, I'm not suggesting in any way that God makes people sick to teach them a lesson or to get something across to them. That's not what I'm suggesting. But I will suggest this to you, that everything that happens in your life, God can use it and turn it around to bring something very positive out in your life. He can use it if you will let Him. The Bible says that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purpose. And so the key there is, are we loving God, and are we moving in our calling according to His purpose in our lives? Are we going forward with that? It's not good enough to say, well, I love God, so everything will work out for good. No, that's not what that scripture says. It actually says that if we love God and are called according to His purpose, in other words, we're pursuing the purpose that we have been called to, then we can expect everything that happens in our life, God can use it for good. He can use it to bring our family together, to help recalibrate the things that are important in our life, to redefine what is both spiritual and what is faith. And there's so many things that can take place if we'll pay attention to what God wants to do through the circumstance that we have in life. I found that some of the most important things came to me through a time of real difficult time, through difficult circumstances. I'm sure lots of us could say the same thing. Some of the key things that have changed in our lives has come through a difficult time in our lives. Now, I don't believe that that's the best way to receive some of these things. I believe there's a better way. What did God say to Joshua? He said to Joshua, keep my words before you. Do not deviate to the left or to the right. Follow my ways and you'll prosper in your days. In other words, that is the way to prosper. The ideal way to prosper before God is to keep His word before you and don't deviate from the way. But many of us have, and we've missed it. And then God will use other things in our lives to shift things around if we'll allow Him to. James 1:17 says, every good present, this is the God's word translation, every good present and every perfect gift comes from above, from the Father who made the sun, moon, and stars. The Father doesn't change like the shifting shadows produced by the sun and the moon. In other words, every good thing that you have in your life has come down from the Father of lights. He is the giver of all good gifts. Everything that's good in your life has come from Him. Each believer has a unique gift. And once we discover that gift, we'll be able to make a mark while we're here on earth. Now you might say, well, Pastor, I've been a Christian for a long time and it seems like I just neglected a lot of things in my life. There's some things that I should have did, I know, even 5 years ago, and I still haven't done them. And so have I missed it? Well, the Bible says that God's gifts, His callings, His gifts and callings are God. His gifts and callings are irrevocable. In other words, one way it says they're without repentance. In other words, He doesn't change His mind. Just because you missed it doesn't mean that you can't go back, you can't take step back a little bit and begin to say, God, what is it that you've done, that you've put in my life? You know, I heard a song yesterday, I believe it was, by a guy by the name of Carlos Santana. Anybody know who he is? Yeah, a few people. He had a wonderful rock band, a great rock band, a famous rock band, many, many years ago. And there was a song that was on the radio last night that I was listening to, because I was wondering, I had heard that he had gotten saved. And it was a song that he recorded in 1992, and it was all about heaven and about the blood of Jesus Christ that was spilled for us to be able to be in the kingdom of God. He had a tremendous gift before he got saved. I mean, he was an awesome guitar player, just something else. He was really, really good. He had a tremendous gift that I believe that was given from God. He was using it in the wrong way, of course. But when he came into the kingdom, he started to use it for the kingdom of God. And you and I today, many times, we might have some things that have happened in our lives, or maybe some gifts that are lying dormant in our lives that we haven't used, or maybe we're using it in a wrong way. God can shift all that around, and we can begin using it for His glory. The gifts and callings of God are without repentance. In other words, He doesn't change His mind. They're a gift that He's given to you, and then He's saying, what are you going to do with it? Because just as when I give a gift to somebody, and I think that they are in need, for instance, in finances, and I give them a gift, a financial gift. I give them $500 because there's something happened in their life that I know they're going to need $500. And they take that gift and go on, do something with it, to go on a vacation or go or have some fun with it. That's their business. It's a gift. I gave it to them. It's up to them what they do with it. It wasn't the reason that I felt that I'd give it to them, but I gave it to them. And when you give it to them, then they decide what they do with it. Might even re-gift it if you want to. You see, when God gives gifts, He lets us decide what we're going to do with them. A lot of responsibility, isn't it? Wouldn't you say? If God has placed in you a gift of doing something special, and you have neglected it. God has placed you in a gift of teaching within you, and you just decided, well, I don't necessarily like kids, so I'm not going to bother trying to be a school teacher. But yet there's a big gift on the inside of you that God wants to well up within you, wants you to use. It's our responsibility. What could we do with it? What do we want to do with the gift and callings of God that God has given us? He won't take them back. So no matter where we're at in life, we can choose whether we want them or not, whether we want to do with them anything with them or not. We have been commissioned by God to serve a purpose while here on earth, the purpose of advancing the kingdom of God, and He has gifted us with an ability to be able to do that. 1 Peter 4:10 says, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. It's a gift. It releases. We're able to release things Man's gift makes room for him and brings him before great men, Proverbs 18:16. In other words, if we will cultivate our gift and use it, you will find that there's a door open to you to be able to use that gift. But it must be done in faith. Now I want us to think about something for a moment. Are we a people of faith? If you're a born-again believer, are you a people of faith? Primarily, what does living by faith mean? I believe it means believing the Word of God. Believing the Word of God. Why do we have to believe the Word of God? Because many other things will teach us opposite to the Word of God. But God wants us to take His Word and believe that we are more than conquerors through Christ. He wants us to believe His Word so that we will know reality. God functions and operates in a different dimension than what this natural dimension is. God functions from the inside out. I remember getting a prophetic word one time by a prophet, and he spoke over me, and he said, look on the inside. Look on the inside, because it's on the inside that you'll be able to see where God is going. And so, in order to have an understanding of the way God operates, we must look on the inside. One of the best ways to look on the inside is look to the Word of God, because Hebrews 4:12 says that the Word of God is powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the soul and the spirit, the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So the Word of God begins to discern how we think, what we are really like, where our motives are. If you look on the inside, we do that by the Word of God. You say, well, what do you mean, Pastor Bill? Well, if we were standing outside and you have never been in this building, I could tell you that when you go in this building, when you get inside, that the walls are all going to be black. There's nothing light in here. It's all black. And you would have no way of knowing. You'd have no way of knowing. You just say, well, should I believe him or not? Well, he said that everything is black, so I guess everything will be black. But what happens when you come on the inside? I can try to convince you and maybe convince you of something that's not real when I'm on the outside. But when I come on the inside, I look around and I can no longer convince you that everything is black, because you can see clearly. You're able to see that the walls are different colors. Well, I'm convinced that when we are in that heavenly realm, that there is nothing that will be hidden that can't be seen. Anything that is hidden, you'll be able to see it, because you'll be seeing it from a different perspective. In other words, if I'm holding something in my heart, if I have wrong motives in my heart, if there are things that are going on in my heart, jealousy towards somebody else, then I'm not going to be able to hide that in heaven. Why? Because I'll be seeing things from a different realm, from a different perspective. I will be able to see that. Everybody will be able to see what's on the inside of me, and I'll be able to see what's on the inside of you. Thank God that's not the way it is here. Some of you are more glad about that than others. I'm really glad about it. I'm glad that some things are hidden here, but I want to make sure that when I get over there, I'm not carrying something in my heart that doesn't fit in heaven. I want the Holy Spirit to cause me to repent where I need to repent, because I don't want to take pride over there on the other side. It will look ugly, and I won't look good in heaven. Amen. And you won't either if you're carrying some of that. You see, God wants us to use this time here on earth to be transformed. Actually, we're being trained, being transformed in order to make it to heaven, in order so that we will fit in heaven. And he's saying, really, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He wants us to function as human beings. And you know, when we get to heaven, we're still going to be human beings. We're not going to change into an angel. We're still going to be human beings. And we'll not necessarily have these bodies. Our bodies will be transformed. But the real you will still be the real you in heaven. Kind of scary, isn't it? Well, we need to make sure that we do everything we can to be transformed into the image of Christ. Now, let me read just a few scriptures to you in Romans. Actually, I'm going to read it from the Message Bible because it's a little bit different. Romans, but it talks about gifts. I'll just go through these really quickly. Romans chapter 12, verse 6. Let's just go ahead and be what we were made to be, without envious or pridefully comparing ourselves with each other, or trying to be something we are not. If you preach, just preach God's message, nothing else. If you help, just help, don't take over. If you teach, stick to your teaching. If you give encouraging guidance, be careful that you don't get bossy. If you're put in charge, don't manipulate. If you're called to give aid to people in distress, keep your eyes open and be quick to respond. If you work with the disadvantaged, don't let yourself get irritated with them or depressed by them. Keep a smile on your face. Love from the center of who you are. Don't fake it. Run for dear life from evil. Hold on for dear life to good. Be good friends who love deeply. Practice playing second fiddle. In other words, you don't have to be number one all the time. Don't burn out. Keep yourselves fueled and aflame. Be alert servants of the Master. Be alert servants. These are all things that we can serve the Lord with. In the King James Version, it talks about gifts. He said, you know, having then gifts different according to the grace that is given to you, let us use them. And then all these gifts about prophecy, about teaching, about faith, about exhortation, about giving, about ministry of helps and so forth. These are all gifts that can be used and developed here on earth. Now, you might say, well, Pastor, you're talking about gifts. Why aren't you talking about 1 Corinthians chapter 11 where it talks all about the gifts of the Spirit? Because the gifts of the Spirit there's 9 gifts of the Spirit that it's talking about in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. But I'm convinced that God actually wants us to be more interested in the gifts that we are going to be able to take into that heavenly realm. Now, the gifts in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 talk about the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge. It talks about the gift of healing. It talks about special faith. It talks about the gift of working of miracles. It talks about the gift of discerning of spirits. Now, every one of those gifts are for the earth. You're not going to need the gift of healing in heaven. We're not going to need the gift of prophecy in heaven. You're not going to need these gifts of miracles in heaven. They'll be of no value in heaven. They're for here. But the things that we talk about this morning, the things that affect your character, belong in heaven as well as here. And what did Paul say? Set your mind on things above and not on things of the earth. So far above everything else, those gifts that will affect our character are more important. They are eternal things. Where the gifts of the Spirit that is mentioned in 1 Corinthians 11, they are for the here and now. Thank God for them. We love them. I thank God for those gifts that we are able to use while we're here on earth. But there's something even deeper. There's something greater. I've noticed something about spiritual gifts. I've noticed something about even miracles take place. I've noticed something about healing over the years. I've seen this too many times than I care to, where people might be miraculously healed in their body, and you would think for sure that's going to keep them in a good place with God. That's going to keep them steady in the Christian life. But yet I've seen them just turn their backs and go in another direction. I know of people who have come into the kingdom because they seen a miracle. They decided they were going to follow God. And because they couldn't deny this miracle take place. But because character was not developed in them, they're spiritual shipwrecks today. You see, the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. He wants us to use them. But he wants us to identify them with the character that we are. He wants us to make sure that they influence our character. If we are an angry person, he wants us to make sure that we get delivered of that anger. if we are a person who is has a lying spirit, he wants us to get rid of that. There's all kinds of things that he wants us to get rid of. The question is today, not whether you have a gift, the question is today, are you going to seek God and see where that is and then develop it, hone it? Because it's part of your destiny. It's part of who God made you to be. And you will find that when you discover your gift, you will enter into a new realm, and it's called a realm of service to others. Because the gifts are for the service of others. Jesus said, I have not come to be served, but to serve. If we don't have the attitude of a servant, we don't have the attitude of our master. If we don't have the attitude of a servant, we don't have the attitude that fits in heaven. How many of you are excited about being a servant in heaven? Yeah, I hope so. I hope those were not only the only hands I've seen are the only ones that have that attitude. Maybe you're just thinking about it. Because if we don't have an attitude of servant, we don't fit in heaven. Why do you think Jesus said you're more blessed to give than to receive? You're more blessed to serve than to be served. So are we going to go out this week and we are going to do some things that will help us identify what our gifts are? And we might stumble around and do some of the craziest things that don't even fit, and we find that it doesn't fit, that it doesn't work, and we might find out, well, that's not my gift. But in other areas, we might surprise. Wow, I did that. I know I could do that pretty good, but I did it. But the fruit from it came was much greater than what I thought. We'll begin to discover our gifting. It helped somebody. I said a few words to some individual, and I'm just amazed how much it encouraged them. You'll discover your gift that way. Stand with me, please.